of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mystery. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have prayed to say in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my fault, therefore I ask Blessed Mary of the Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord and our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Thank you.
Whether it's good or bad, whether it's going to help us or damage us. But only churchy here that we shouldn't judge, that doesn't mean that we're not going to see things that we're going to consider are wrong, that we're going to consider are bad, that might go against everything that we stand for. And we're going to want to be quick to pass judgment and say that whoever is causing that for whatever reason is wrong and is bad. But the fact of the matter is, we can't say that about the person. We can say that about the person's actions, but we don't know why that person did what he or she did. Only God sees that. So in the end, we can judge each other from what we see, from what we know, from what we think, even according to our civil and religious laws. But when it comes to who we truly are, to what we will be in eternity, well, only God sees that, and only God knows that. And I think that's why Jesus said at one point, the tax collectors and prostitutes would precede us in the kingdom of heaven. Remember that? And there's so much hypocrisy in the world, but yet, everyone is so quick to judge. And in today's gospel, we see how Jesus' disciples are being judged. Why? Because they're not fasting. They're not fasting like the Pharisees. They're not fasting like the other authority in religion. They're not fasting like St. John's disciples. So they're being judged for that. And Jesus gives the response. We know what that meant. Jesus is with them. Why should they fast when God is walking among them and in their presence? Why? It's not a moment to fast. But that was just Jesus' way of saying, hey, don't judge, because their experience is different than your experience. And you see, this is just to get you to where I want to explain what I saw yesterday. And right away, I preach on it. And you see, last time that I had a mass in the Filipino community, for some reason, in my heart, I felt that I had to bring back that story that St. Louis de Montfort tells in the True Devotion to Mary about that peasant that was in line to see his king with all types of different people, dignitaries, religious figures. There was a huge line to visit the king, and there was this peasant in line with everyone else, and he noticed that everyone had something beautiful to offer the king as a gift, but all he had was an apple from his orchard, and he was there in line, and all he had was this apple. And at a certain point, the king's mother, she saw that there was this person with this apple, and she must have seen something in this peasant, because she thought, I know how to, I'll help him so that when he gets to my son will receive that apple as one of the greatest gifts he could possibly receive, even though he's getting gifts of gold here. So what is it that the queen does? She goes and she looks for the king's favorite platter. She knows how the king likes his apple. He likes it peeled and cut in four. So she puts it on that platter, peeled and cut in four. And then she accompanies the peasant to present this apple to the king. The king is delighted at seeing his mother with this peasant and this fresh apple cut before, and he eats his apple and is happy and is grateful, and everything goes well for that peasant. Well, Our Lady tells us that that's what she does for us, because we're imperfect, because we fall, because we're weak, but she's always trying to present us to her son in the best way possible. You see, that's what I preached on last night. That itself was, wow, incredible, beautiful. Even though we've heard it, always to remember it, it always touches my heart. But you see, today, I saw something different. Something different in that. That's what I want to share with you. But you see, before I get to that, I have to also trying to talk to a bee about something other than that, and I'll get to what I'm talking about without saying anything because it's gross, but if you try and talk to a bee about something else, that other, the bee's not going to understand you. Well, think of a fly. Bees like flowers and beautiful scent. What is it that the fly usually lands on? And what is it that the fly knows? Well, in the same way that you can't explain to the bee what the fly likes, well, you can't explain to the fly what the bee likes because it doesn't know what the bee likes. It hasn't had that experience. So we have to ask ourselves, what experience do we want to live as God's bees? Do we want to fly around from flower to flower, meaning meeting each other and looking only at the bad and only focusing on the bad and making our judgment on the bad? Or do we want to see what's good in a person without no judgment? Without no judgment, because only God knows, and we don't know why that person is in that situation. So who are we to condemn that person? Maybe we see the actions, but we must look for the good, and the good is simply in seeing that person in the image of God and loving that person as Jesus loved us by dying to ourselves, which means, who am I to judge that person? Who am I to condemn that person? I'm here to love that person, to seek what's good in that person, and to help that person. But I'm frustrated with that person. What is this? I'm frustrated with that person. Does a bee get frustrated? If a bee got frustrated, would a bee be able to do his job? Remember, they're worker bees, just like we're militant Christians. Would they be able to do their job and produce that honey? Imagine if bees stopped to judge each other. If bees, instead of landing on flowers, landed on what the fly lands on. It would be horrible. It would be chaotic, kind of like what's happening with mankind, right? We need to learn from the bees. We need to learn from them. But brothers and sisters, that's not even the homily. That's not even the point. That's not even what God put in my heart to share with you this morning. All that's just to bring you there. One more thing my spiritual father told me. And I remember he told me this early on. He told me this to help me understand why I couldn't judge my brothers that were in my community. Because imagine being in a community with a bunch of men, and we're all young, and we all want to be saints, but at the same time, we're all horrible sinners, and we're doing our best. But there's going to be judgment, right? Because we all know that we have to follow certain rules, and there's certain things we need to do, and, you know, they're tattletale all the time. And, you know, there's going to be that in the community. We're really good here, look what he's doing, look what that person is doing. Oh, he hasn't done this. There's judgment, but there shouldn't be judgment. There should be compassion. We should be landing on flowers, not on. So my spiritual father said to me, and he told me the story. He said, never judge. And he told me the story because he knew I was fascinated with the monks of Manathas, the monastic republic of Greece. He told me the story of a monk that lived in one of these monasteries. And this monk was a holy man of God. Early on, he received the gift from God. And the gift from God was that he would never sleep all night. He would pray. Didn't have insomnia. He had the gift of being able to vigil, means being in prayer all night. Now, this was a gift given to him by God so that he could intercede for the world. He was in this monastery. He was living his holy monastic life. But at one point, his spiritual father started seeing something in him. Maybe that he was maybe a little bit proud, you know, even though this was a gift from God, but people were beginning to regard him as a holy man because they would see him, that he would always pray during the night, and the chaplain would be there all night, and when prayer began, he was already there. So his spiritual father seeing this said, oh, okay, he received this gift from God, but it's making him proud. So we don't want one of God's gifts to corrupt this man, and that might seem incredible to you. How can one of God's gifts corrupt this man? Well, this is a gift from God. God's gifts come with responsibility. They're the talents that we can't only receive and hide, but we have to bring out more, and we have to do for God with the talent that he gave us, what he's calling us to do. So seeing how this man was falling into pride because of that, he said, listen, as your spiritual father, from now on I give you this obedience. You're going to vigil in yourself where no one can see you before the holy icon is there. And you're always going to be late to prayer. But nobody's going to know that I made the disobedience. So this man, this monk, continued praying. But then he would always be late. And guess what happened? His brother started to judge him.
Oh, the holy monk, you're so holy. You couldn't sleep the night. Now you can't get up on time.
Guess what? When he died, it was revealed that the spiritual father had given him that obedience and that he did victory all the thing. He was never actually late to prayer. He was just doing what he was told. But that was so that he wouldn't fall into pride. But look at the other brothers and how they fell. All of them sinned by judging him because they didn't know why he was doing what he was doing. But you see, why did she never judge, which means condemn? Because only a judge can give a sentence. Anybody can see something and point it out to be wrong, but only a judge can say if that's truly right or wrong after hearing all the facts. And when it comes to us as a person, only God can judge us. Really, only God can judge us. But we often judge each other, and that's horrible, really. So getting back to what this homily is all about, St. Louis de Montfort, Our Lady, the apple, the peasant. It's always beautiful to think of how Mary will take who we are, transform us, and present us to God. And that's beautiful to think that Mary would do that. But in my rule, in my religious community, the rule written by my founder, the man that I speak from, Padre Antonio Saracheno, we have something that gives us a command and the rule to be another Mary. We're called in my community, and imagine how difficult that is, but we're called to try and be another Mary. That's why in my religious community, we all take the name of Mary. But you see, that hit me hard yesterday when I thought of St. Louis de Montfort, and I thought of what I had shared with you last time, that I celebrated a feast with the Filipino community. Because I'm often imagining myself as that peasant that doesn't have much to offer to God. And I imagine Our Lady coming to my aid and helping me with that, presenting me to God in a way acceptable. But yesterday I understood that if I'm called to be another Mary, then I have to look for the peasant with the apple. That means the person that's considered to be the last, the lowly, the undesirable, the one that has not much to offer, the most sinful, the person who hasn't gotten a confession, the person that might be committing a mistake or horrible sins, but for some reason cannot get out of that, or maybe they're not even doing anything wrong, but yet our judgment leads us to believe that they are, so we've landed on what the fly lands, which seems to be the bee. There's no polling for us. All there is judgment that's only of God, when we can be like the bee and see what's good in that person. And then be like Mary and present that which is good to God instead of the bad that we see that we're condemning and judging the person for. So you see, Christianity, life, things are not the way that they might seem. Apparently, there's always more because God is infinite. So if in our quest for religion, in our quest for spirituality, our quest for morality, we're still judging, then we need to start all over again. Because no one has the right to condemn anyone else. Because there's 100 reasons why somebody does something or doesn't do something. And unless we know that, then we should just pray for that person. Seek what's good in that person, even if it's as simple as one apple from our orchard. So we must help that person to present that gift to God, to the King, as Mary does for us, because we're called to be another Mary. Vatican II presents Mary as the perfect disciple, the first Christian, and the best example of what it means to be. So today, as we celebrate the Divino Niño, let us ask him to be able to learn from his mother in the way that he learned from his mother. To be love, to be who God wants us to be,
We have all gathered here, dear brothers and sisters, to celebrate the mysteries of our redemption. Let us therefore ask Almighty God that the whole world may be watered from these springs of all blessing and life.
For all who have bowed themselves to God, that with His help they may faithfully keep to bear this soul. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For peace among nations that live from all turmoil, that people may say God in freedom of heart. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For the elderly who suffer from isolation and sickness, that they may be strengthened by our love for them as brothers and sisters. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For ourselves, God, we hear that as a God does not cease to sustain us with the things of this life, we may know how to use them in such a way that they may hold even now to the things that endure forever. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
For all being loved, blessed for whom this mass is being offered. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayers.
Let us pray for one of our long time and dear parishioners who just passed away. For it was Leonie. Let us pray that she is with God now, and our lady has presented her to Him in the most beautiful ways. For this intention, for all the intentions of our heart, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, we hear our prayers.
May your mercy, we beseech you, O Lord, be with your people who cry to you, so that what they seek at your prompting they may obtain by your ready generosity. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Before you sit down, I just want to give testimony to something that I just thought of. When I first came to this parish over 15 years ago, I visited Naomi, who just passed away. She was very ill, and at that time, we were praying for her because we thought the Lord would take her. Imagine that. 15 years later, she passed away. See how God works in mysterious ways. up your heart. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord, for out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross, he freed us from an enemy of death, and by rising from the dead, he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end, we acclaim.
In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours,
forever and ever.
Thank you.
Let us. Pour on us.